attendance is steadily growing, so why don't we get started now? My name is Nicholas Carides, and I want to welcome you on behalf of the Hellenic-American Cultural Foundation to the first in a series of virtual events which may become the new normal for the foreseeable future. As you may know, this foundation was organized 9 years ago to promote high quality and relevant educational and cultural programs and events for persons interested in the rich history and legacy of Greece. Our goal is to remain relevant and inspirational, even during a pandemic, and we will continue to find ways and different media to reach our audience and the community. Tonight, we are very fortunate to have someone who has made enormous contributions to the understanding of the history of Byzantium and who has devoted most of her life to studying and interpreting Byzantine civilization. Before we begin, I want to thank a few people who have made this event possible. First, we want to thank Pericles Mazarakis, a foundation board member who suggested this exciting program and helped put the event together. He will introduce Professor Mavroudi and moderate the questions at the end of the presentation. We also want to thank Peter Bezos, the foundation's treasurer, who was involved extensively in the logistics and technical matters for this evening. Finally, we want to thank Jacob Peters. Jacob offered to get involved with the foundation last fall, and I'm not sure that he fully understood the significance of his role. He has been our tech consultant and has been both instrumental and invaluable in helping us structure tonight's event. And now let me ask Pericles to introduce Professor Mavroudi.
Thank you, Nick, and good afternoon, everyone. I see that we have reached now 175 participants, which in itself is very exciting for the first virtual lecture series that we're putting together. I don't know a better person to have the privilege to introduce than Maria. I am thrilled as she's not only a renowned scholar, but also a very close friend and also a kumbara, as we've baptized Eleni Erato, her daughter. On many of our joint family trips, it has been such a treat to hear her encyclopedic knowledge around the intersection between Greek history, Byzantine culture, and Islamic studies. Maria was born in Thessaloniki, Greece, and studied philology at the University of Thessaloniki before earning her PhD in Byzantine studies at Harvard. Her scholarly work began by focusing on a 10th century Byzantine book on dream interpretation that had been widely received in Latin and the European vernaculars and counted as a Christian dream book of the Middle Ages. During the next 2 decades, she worked on identifying the place of these translations within Byzantine literary culture and its reception in East and West during the medieval and early modern period. This begs reconsidering the position of the ancient Greek classics within the Byzantine, Arabic, and Latin intellectual traditions, as well as the supposed marginality of Byzantium within the broader medieval intellectual universe. Her work was recognized with a MacArthur Fellowship in 2002, otherwise known as the Genius Award. And Maria Mavroudi is currently a professor of Byzantine history and classics at the University of California, Berkeley. It gives me tremendous pleasure and honor as our first lecturer at the Hellenic American Cultural Foundation to welcome Maria. And we're looking very much forward to a very productive and stimulating lecture. At the end of the lecture, we will have Q&A. For those of you who want to ask questions, on the bottom of the screen, there's a Q&A button. Please write the questions, and I will try to curate the questions and be able at the end to ask them to Maria to be answered. Thank you very much, and Maria, the floor is yours.
So I also want to thank everybody who contributed to organizing this lecture. but especially Pericles, because he literally dictated the topic to me. And I also want to thank my son, George Papadopoulos, who is my technical consultant, helping me with any glitches that might occur on this side. So what is Byzantium and what does it mean for us today? Bluntly put, in the most simple possible terms, Byzantium is the eastern part of the Roman Empire that never fell to any barbarians. The name Byzantium, as Byzantinists well know, is a neologism. It's not a term that ever the Byzantines used for themselves. And it was not a term that other peoples used for the Byzantines. In fact, their neighbors to the east, Syriacs, Persians, later Arabs, later Turks, would call them Romans, which is the name that they called themselves by, because they understood themselves as the heirs to the Roman Empire. And this is the reason why modern Greeks still call themselves Romani. So the complication with the name Roman started occurring around the early 9th century when Charlemagne and later monarchies in Western Europe started claiming the legacy of Rome for themselves more and more forcefully. And this has determined a lot of the modern reception of Byzantium. The person who introduced this neologism, Byzantium, or made it current, is a 16th century scholar and historian named Hieronymus Wolf. And he's to this day still very influential in how we divide up Byzantine history into periods, and is also influential in how we understand medieval history as at large, as a chunk of history between antiquity and modernity. So already by the end of the 19th century, there are different definitions of Byzantium and what are its constituent parts. And usually what you hear it is Roman law, Hellenism, Christianity, and sometimes you also hear Oriental despotism. This is a very old definition, as I say, current already since the end of the 19th century. And this led to debates about each constituent element, like how important it is, how compatible with one another these constituent elements are. For example, Roman law implies limits to arbitrary royal power, which is not compatible with so-called Oriental despotism. And then another problem is what exactly is the role of Hellenism in Byzantium, especially since the Byzantines understood the ancient heritage in different terms than we do and valued things about it that were very different than what we value. So Byzantium means different things for us today, depending on where we live and what cultural, intellectual, or religious tradition we each subscribe. It's different in different languages, in different scholarly traditions, and it would take a book to write about each one in and of itself. So I'm gonna try and be extremely brief now. It means, of course, different things in countries that are overwhelmingly Orthodox Christian and in countries that are not. And especially since Greek was the administrative and literary language of Byzantium for most of its millennial existence, it means special things if you live in the Greek-speaking world of the late 20th century, which is Greece, the northernmost part, Thessaloniki. This is a mosaic of perhaps 7th century mosaic of the patron saint of Thessaloniki, and all the way to the Greek-speaking south, which is Cyprus, with the example here is the 6th or 7th century apse mosaic of Panagia Angeloktisti at Kyti. And so speaking Greek is an important element in the reception of Byzantium. And then of course in countries where Greek is no longer spoken, it means different things, but it's still there understood as part of a local past. For example, in Italy, where this famous Ravenna mosaic of Justinian still stands, it is understood as part of a local past. And since Ravenna is a little bit in the Italian north, one would say, the meaning of Byzantium is very different in the Italian south, in Sicily, that has a longer history of Greek presence, and that to this day in modern Italian politics, the Greek past of Sicily sets it apart and kind of subsidizes ideas of autonomy of Sicily from the rest of Italy. An iconic Byzantinizing moment are the Byzantine mosaics at the Norman Cathedral in Monreale in Sicily from the 1180s. And for the Slavic world, Byzantium, of course, is the source of Orthodox Christianity, for that part of the Slavic world that is Orthodox. And also, regardless of what brand of Christianity one subscribes to, it is also the source of the oldest Slavic alphabet, which meant effectively the creation of a written literature in Slavic. Of course, various nationalist movements in the 19th and 20th centuries in the Balkans resulted in different understandings of what the exact relationship, cultural and other, was between Byzantium and the Slavs. And this made an impact on how we understand the legacy of Byzantium today and how Byzantine studies developed in each country. And another complicated case, of course, is Turkey. That had been the heartland of the Byzantine Empire for most of its millennial existence. It's where most of the most important Byzantine monument, the Church of Hagia Sophia, still stands. And of course, the reception of Byzantium there has changed over several decades. During the Ottoman Empire, the study of Byzantium in the late 19th century primarily belonged to the Christian minorities, and especially the Greeks and the Armenians. After there were no longer Greeks and Armenians in significant numbers in Turkey during the Turkish Republic, we have it from the pen of Stephen Runciman, one of the famous Byzantinists of the 20th century, that in 1942, Ataturk's successor Ismet İnönü was driving around and saw a Byzantine monument. He asked what this was and nobody could tell him. And he became very angry that this was part of the past and nobody knew what to say about it. And he asked that somebody come and teach, be invited from abroad to come and teach Byzantine history in Istanbul, which was the only university in Turkey at the time. And his Minister of Education addressed himself to the British Council, and as a result, Stephen Runciman came to teach for 3.5 years, and he reported on the conditions of teaching. It's an extremely interesting report, and I don't have time to go into it. Later on, with the emergence of Blue Anatolianism in Turkey, where every culture that ever flourished on the territory of Turkey can be understood as part of the Turkish past, this idea created a niche for Byzantine studies that was very different than the one that had been in place during the Ottoman period. So depending on in places where there was no local past with Byzantium and no Byzantine monuments, again, there was a very different reception. For example, in France, before the French Revolution, Byzantium was a useful example of absolutism, of how to basically do a good bureaucratic, how to run a good bureaucratic monarchy. So it was something to aspire to. But since the period of the Enlightenment in the 19th century was against monarchies, this helped make Byzantium anathema, both in the French intellectual tradition after the Revolution, during its intellectual preparation with the Enlightenment, and a little bit still stands today. In the German-speaking lands, as I said, much of the reception was determined by the fact that Byzantium was a contender of the Roman legacy, and it was driven by the study of the Holy Roman Empire, which was understood as a German body politic. So the German reception of Byzantium was greatly influenced by Byzantium's claim to the Roman legacy. In the US, the reception of Byzantium starts with, I guess, the very dawn of, in the artistic domain, in the applied arts, and as part of an aesthetic that comes forward with modernism. And that starts a little bit toward the end of the 19th and the early 20th century. The first Byzantinist set foot in the 1930s. It was the Russian Byzantinist Alexander Vasiliev, who fled the Soviet Union and started teaching at the University of Wisconsin. But more than the academic reception, the broader reception is what most people are familiar with. So following an image of Byzantium that had been forged in Germany in the late 19th and early 20th century, Byzantium stood for firm political control by the state, control of the economic and political situations, security, etc. And that was particularly attractive during the New Deal that tried to manage the repercussions of the Great Depression. So this is why on a number of American campuses, there are Byzantinizing buildings. I think the best known that appear most frequently in movies are those at the UCLA campus. Here at Berkeley, where I teach, we also have our little Byzantine building. It used to be, it was built as the old art gallery of the university and has a facade decorated with Byzantine mosaics. Right here, you are looking at the allegory of music. It's allegories of the seven arts. And it is certainly part of the New Deal politics. And it is even inscribed on the building. The mosaics were added in 1936-37 as part of the New Deal. And there is an ideological component in choosing a Byzantinizing monument, as I said, because it reflects stability, security, conservatism. This image has changed radically after the Second World War. And the reason has to do with a more general narrative about Western civilization that was in place before the Second World War and how this narrative became after the Second World War and especially from the 1980s onwards. So the most important influence in English is that of Edward Gibbon, a famous 18th century historian and politician, whose multi-volume work, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, was standard reading for British politicians, certainly up to Winston Churchill and perhaps beyond. I cannot vouch for politicians today, but it is an extremely influential piece of historical work that is still echoed both in scholarly and non-scholarly writing to this day. Part of the secret for its success is the beautiful English in which it is written. And it is reflected in the beautiful English of John Julian Norwich, the popular author who did the most to familiarize a younger generation of readers with Byzantium. And Gibbon is a secular Enlightenment piece of work. It's anti-Christian. It's anti-clerical, anti-monarchical, anti-Oriental, and therefore anti-Byzantine. And the interpretations of Gibbon have long been abandoned by professional Byzantinists, but still there is no position for Byzantium that has been found, and no narrative of a history of civilization has been found in which Byzantium would appear, or even without Byzantium, we don't have any narrative. The old narrative, the one we are in the process of revising, but only incrementally, especially regarding literary culture, which is what I study most closely, is that the sciences were born in the ancient Near East, and then they were transferred to the Greek world. The Greek world furnished them with a theoretical background, especially in philosophy. So philosophy is understood in this old narrative as a Greek product of antiquity. And philosophy and the sciences flourished in the Greco-Roman world. The Romans picked them up and also helped them flourish, at most until the 7th century. And then they died out because it's the end of antiquity and the beginning of the Middle Ages, and they would have completely disappeared had it not been for the Arabs, who conquered a big part of what had been the Byzantine or the Roman Empire, and became masters of a world empire themselves, and especially in the course of the 9th and 10th centuries, translated a lot of Greek scientific and philosophical material into Arabic. This is understood as a migration of knowledge from the Greco-Roman to the Islamic world. And in the Islamic world, philosophy and science, these fundamental goods for Western modernity, flourished until at most the beginning of the 12th century, where presumably the Islamic world started entering decline, and were picked up through translations from Arabic into Latin in the 12th century that led to a proto-Renaissance or a proto-modernity. But the true Renaissance came only in the 14th and 15th centuries when Greek intellectuals fleeing Byzantium that was falling to the Ottomans came to Italy and elsewhere in Western Europe and brought with them not their understanding of ancient Greek authors, but manuscripts of the Greek authors. So they brought the texts and they taught the ancient Greek language to Western Europeans, who were the first ones after antiquity, presumably, to correctly understand what these ancient texts meant. So this is the old narrative. In this narrative, Byzantium is given a passive role. It's supposed to have preserved things rather than have added anything creative of its own. And so there's no real position for Byzantium in this old narrative. Now, in the post-colonial universe in which we live, especially the narrative about the decline of the Islamic world from the 12th century onwards has been attacked and is in the process of being revised. But as I said, there is no real position for Byzantium. Byzantium is absent from a lot of these things. Given that Western civilization considered Greco-Roman antiquity as one of its foundational stones, that in the post-colonial world, during the demolition of colonial empires after the Second World War, made the Greco-Roman legacy suspect. And this is why, especially from the 1980s, and as we speak, we have the phenomenon of scholars of the ancient Greco-Roman world, and especially the Greek classics, apologizing for the colonial purposes to which their discipline has been put. Byzantium does not really need to do this because in this whole narrative, it has always been the orientalized other and the underdog. And for this reason, in a post Second World War universe, there were windows of opportunity that put it to the foreground. Again, it was practicing artists more than practicing scholars that received the vibe, at least as far as I can see. And the reason was not so much the history of Byzantine studies in the States or anywhere else in the world, but political events were happening on the ground, and especially the civil rights movement. In 1965, those who were old enough to remember, what happened was that the Greek Orthodox Archbishop of America, Iakovos, was one of the very few non-African American clergymen who marched together with Martin Luther King in Selma, Alabama. And he was also the only non-African American religious leader who chose to do that. And that's how he made, together with Martin Luther King, the cover of Life magazine in 1965. So in many ways, Orthodox Christianity, that was a non-white Anglo-Saxon Protestant form of Christianity, was for a moment at the forefront of the civil rights movement. In addition, at around the same time, from the 1950s and into the 1970s, the Archbishop and later President of Cyprus, Archbishop Makarios, became the face of anti-British colonial struggle everywhere where British colonialism had been. To this day, I did an internet search. There are avenues named after Makarios from sub-Saharan Africa to Pakistan. And especially in sub-Saharan Africa, there's a lot of children baptized by the name of Makarios. It's not what I say. There has been scholarly work done on this. And it is extremely interesting how Makarios, through his anti-colonial struggle, became a kind of honorary African. He paid a lot of official visits to several sub-Saharan African countries. Here is his official, one of his official visits to Kenya. As a result of these visits, there is an Orthodox seminary that he helped found in Nairobi that to this day services all of Africa. So there's an Orthodox African church that is especially run by the Orthodox Patriarchate of Alexandria, but it has to this day a particularly Cypriot twist. As I said, because Makarios managed to assert himself as an honorary African through his anti-colonial struggle. The repercussions of this that I have felt in the Bay Area is the existence of an African Orthodox Church in San Francisco under the its patron saint is Saint John Coltrane, a famous jazz musician who died in 1967. And the icons of Saint John Coltrane that I'm going to show you in a minute were painted by Mark Dukes, who was trained in Byzantine iconographical style at an Eastern Orthodox monastery in Texas. He had wanted to become an Orthodox monk, then he decided this life was not for him. Right now, he serves as an African Orthodox priest at the Church of Saint John Coltrane, where, as I said, he painted several of the icons that are very well known, at least in the Bay Area. And this is the icon of the patron saint of the church where Mark Dukes is a priest, Saint John Coltrane, as I said, with his saxophone. And then other depictions of Saint John Coltrane, a little bit in the guise of Christ, again, always with his saxophone. Mark Dukes also painted an Episcopalian church here in the Bay Area. It's the church of St. Gregory of Nyssa. And it is famous for murals that are painted at the upper part of the church, the half upper part. Gregory of Nyssa is very positive toward dancing, and this Episcopalian church has a ritual that includes dancing. And the mosaic above, the fresco above depicts a dancing Christ and approximately 100 figures from history that are also dancing. Not all of them are canonized saints in any Christian tradition, and some of them are not even Christian themselves. So it's an all-inclusive, and I couldn't find identifications for all of the saints, but for example, in this picture, we have the man in the turban is Saadi, the Persian national poet. I think next to him may be Saint Teresa of Avila. The man with the wolf is Saint Francis of Assisi, and et cetera, So this is a new face for Orthodox Christianity and the Byzantine culture especially. And none of it would have been possible without something that happened in Greece in the 1920s and 1930s. And this was the career of Fotis Kontoglou. Fotis Kontoglou, to my mind, is by far the most influential modern Greek painter. He came from Asia Minor, from Turkey, as a result of the exchange of populations between Greece and Turkey in 1922. At the time that he came, the Byzantine tradition of icons was no longer as we know it. It had been completely westernized under Russian influence. So icons were done in Western style. single-handedly he reintroduced the Byzantine style, not only for icon painting, but also in order to depict history and everyday life, recent history. The history, not only Byzantine history, but also the history of the Turkish, the Ottoman period, the Greeks under Ottoman rule, and also 20th century Greek history and everyday life. He died in 1965. His most creative decade was the 1930s. This was painted, what I'm showing you was painted in 1937 at the Town Hall of Athens. It still stands, and in the recent years, it has received renewed attention. And as you can see, let me see if I can remember who the figures are. Okay, so the figures above in the upper zone are the late Byzantine historian Franzis, who wrote about the fall of Constantinople to the Ottomans, the painter Panselinos of the early Ottoman period. After him, Dominikos Theotokopoulos, then the hero of the Greek Revolution, Odysseas Androutsos, Rigas Phereos, Athanasios Diakos, Theodoros Kolokotronis, and Georgios Karaiskakis. I think those of you who are familiar, Greeks in the audience, I'm sure can identify all of them. Underneath are scenes from Greek history. It begins with, above the door, the man on the horse is Alexander the Great. And what is depicted here is the taming of Alexander's horse, Bucephalus. And after that, you have Emperor Basil I in the next wall above the other door. And next to it is what I showed earlier, is John Tzimiskis to the left of this slide, and the Doxapatris, all of them fighting against Arabs, Franks, etc. And we know that Kondoglou studied everything that he depicted in kind of Western style, because we still have the sketches, but he delivered everything in Byzantine style. So Pericles, well known to the left, this is the study for him, done in Byzantine style to the center, and then Byzantine style again for Emperor Konstantinos Paleologos. And we still ask, why did everybody had to have a Byzantine guise in Kondoglou's work? Again, Kondoglou's influence in America beyond the African-American community is felt in this iconographer, Robert Lenz, who is a Franciscan friar and a Greek Catholic. He says himself in his self-narrative, his biographical narrative, that he was trained by an iconographer who had been trained in the Kondoglou tradition. He names Kondoglou. And he uses the Byzantine style in order to raise a lot of social issues that are particularly pertinent to American life, but also to reflect his experiences in third world countries and also in Africa. The first time I came across his work was in 1990 through this picture of the Lion of Judah. So this is Christ according to the prophetic tradition of the Old and the New Testament. Usually, Christ as a Lion of Judah is depicted as a young child asleep, Christ anapeson. I don't have the time to explain what this is, but I thought I'd juxtapose these two images for you to see what a radical departure from tradition, but within certain iconographic elements of the tradition, the Lion of Judah made by Robert Lenz is. So this is Jesus Christ as a Maasai warrior and depicted with a scroll at his feet, because this is how Christ as a Lion of Judah appears in the book of Revelation. As I said, I could be talking half an hour about this. I don't have the time to do it. And another icon that was painted by Robert Lenz is this icon of Saint Sergius and Bacchus. Scholars agree that this is a misunderstanding, that Saint Sergius and Bacchus were homosexual, like gay lovers. No matter what, this has become an icon in the gay community, especially since it appeared at the gay parade in Chicago in 1995. And then there is another gay icon, Harvey Milk of San Francisco. I play with the word icon. I don't mean icon in the religious sense, but icon in the broader sense. So Agios Arvis, Harvey Milk, Saint Harvey Milk, according to Robert Lenz. I want to emphasize, I'm not saying that this utilization, I am saying that the utilization of Byzantine style and the icon style, the religious icon style, to bring social issues to the fore by Robert Lenz is controversial. I'm not taking a position regarding this, but whether we like it or not, the Byzantine style and its attendant Orthodox Christianity have been employed by creative artists in order to connote not conservatism like they did with the New Deal, but a kind of radical social and political positions, and especially what identifies with the subaltern, in order to use a current academic term. So this is most of my talk, and this had not been my original plan when I agreed to the invitation. So I'm going to spend 5 minutes, and that will be it, to talk about a rehabilitation of Byzantium as it was experienced by Byzantinists within the academic field of Byzantium that still has not been taken on board by other fields, and also in a broader understanding of Byzantium. In an older understanding of Byzantium, this was an empire in decline, the decline and fall of the Roman Empire by Gibbon actually reflects an understanding that Byzantium was 1,000 years of decline. After the Second World War, scholars have more forcefully asserted that it's not possible to be talking about 1,000 years of decline. Instead of looking what caused Byzantium to decline, we have to see what enabled it to survive for so long. After all, it is the most longevous empire that we know of at any point in history. Byzantium is punctuated by its moments of glory. Its greatest territorial expansion was undoubtedly reached under the Empire of Justinian in the 6th century. Justinian reconquered a good part of the Western territories. He was a native speaker of Latin. He understood himself as a Roman emperor in both East and West. And then in the 7th century, with the advent of the Arabs, significant parts of the Eastern provinces and also North Africa and the Western Mediterranean were curtailed. But in the next moment of glory in the 10th century, especially under Emperor Basil II, Byzantium has regained at least some of the territories that it still had under Justinian. And this is, in the old narrative, 1025 is the moment of Basil's death and also the moment of Byzantium's last glory. And then from now on, the 11th century, the 12th, down to 1453, is all decline, decline, decline. This idea of decline started being questioned by especially economic historians already in the 1970s. The oldest article in this vein I was able to find is by Michael Handy, a numismatist, and then more work followed by Alan Harvey. The argument, the new argument that came to be made is that Byzantium may be contracting territorially from the 11th century onwards, but its economy is expanding. And Basil may have been a conqueror emperor and a good military emperor, but he was famously very stingy, at least that's what Psellos tells us, and money that is kept in a treasure box is not useful money, it's not good money. Good money is money that circulates. So the 11th century emperors that were criticized by their contemporary historiography for being spendthrifts were actually doing a good thing by spending the money that Basil II wouldn't spend. And so the argument is made, the reason I mentioned some of the Byzantinists, these are all British Byzantinists, and start making this argument at a very at a crux moment in modern British history. It's when after the Second World War, the British colonial empire has collapsed. And so it is an empire that is territorially contracting, but it is an empire that needs to think whether it still maintains its position within the modern world. And also, soon after that, in the 1990s, I believe, it is a big transformation of British economy, from an economy of production. So you make, woolen textiles and luxury cars, to an economy of services. You attract banking and shipping and things like that. So in the course of this transformation of the British territory and the British economy, British Byzantinists are thinking that this had also been the case for Byzantium in the 11th century. And this opened up a new avenue for appreciating Byzantium. Down to my last couple of minutes of my talk. A very important book that appeared in the 1990s was by Paul Magdaleno, another British Byzantinist, who studied the empire of Manuel Komnenos and made the argument that Byzantium was not an orthodox monster that nobody can understand, that existed in medieval isolation, did not interact with anybody, but was in effect an empire like other contemporary empires of the 12th century. There's a Byzantine Empire circa 1170. I apologize for the typo in the slide. So we're in the 12th century, not in the 11th. And things were, still going fine down to around 1070 when right before an important defeat of Manuel by the Turks, the Seljuk Turks. Now, the moment that really brought this integration of Byzantium the way we knew it is the Fourth Crusade that caused a dividing up of the Byzantine Empire as reflected in this map. And then a recovery around 1261, Constantinople was taken back by the Byzantines. And there was an effort to reconstitute a shadow of the Byzantine Empire's former self under the last Byzantine dynasty, the Paleologi. What I find very interesting, and this is the end of my lecture now, is a juxtaposition of, let me find my last slide, of the empire of Manuel Komnenos around 1170 with the empire of Mehmed the Conqueror upon his death in 1481. It is very interesting that in modern history, the argument is made that under the Komneni, Byzantium is declining. Yet, with almost exact same territorial coverage, the empire of Mehmed the Conqueror is thriving. I am not going to discuss this, there is no time, but I want to leave you with exactly this question. What does it mean for an empire to decline? What does decline and fall mean? What stays after the end of an empire's political existence? And also the different ways that we understand this legacy today. There is no doubt in my mind that things happened once in a particular way. But we as humans who look for something useful in our own past and the past of other peoples, we keep interpreting the same facts in different ways, depending on what's around us at any given moment. Thank you for your attention. And I'm ready for questions now. I cannot hear you.
Thank you very much, Maria. We have 5-6 questions, but I want to start from a broader question, which is what got you interested in the field of Byzantinology and what motivated you to pursue it from a broader perspective? And I'm going to go into the specific questions that the audience had.
Okay, so this is a little bit of an existential and autobiographical question, and I'll answer it as it is. I was born and was educated in Greece, and there the national curriculum and the way national history is given to school children from elementary school to high school and Lycio pays disproportionate attention to the 500 years that are Greek antiquity, especially classical civilization, compared to 1,000 years that is Byzantine history. I also grew up in Thessaloniki, that is a very Byzantine city still in its urban fabric and a lot of its buildings today. And I realized that there was very little of what I was seeing around me that my education, as provided by the Greek state, was preparing me to understand. So then this became a personal quest. I need to understand this for myself.
I'm going to navigate through some of the questions, and hopefully we can get through all of them. But, you know, what were the major reasons for the decline of the Byzantine Empire? Was it religious infighting? Was it poor leadership, civil war battles, Fourth Crusade? What was the root cause?
Okay, so as the different, as I said, there are many different interpretations of how we should evaluate the decline. And accordingly, depending on what you count as decline, I'm not evading the question. I'm just using the tools that the historical profession has had, at least since the 1970s, so 50 years now and counting, to discuss history at large, not just Byzantine history. So it's a problem. What constitutes decline? So depending on what you define as decline, then you identify an appropriate reason. Religion is a reason that was a big favorite with Gibbon. What other reasons? I forget now which reasons you kind of you enumerate. I don't remember.
Infighting, leadership issues.
There is always a lack of good leaders. Even the very good, as we all know, from the present and from the recent past and from the remote past, good leadership is hard to find. Even the best leaders deemed as best leaders in any context are, the question has been asked, which were the good American presidents? And everybody has a different answer. Same for that. I mean, I insist, I don't want to answer this question any more concretely than that. It's there's certainly infighting. Where isn't infighting? I mean, when there's political stake, I mean, all of the above, let's say.
As a friar, what is Lenz's point religiously by depicting these American figures?
I do not know because I'm not him. but I can say my reaction to seeing his icons and also the icons of Mark Dukes, like the Episcopalian fresco, the dancing figures that I showed. Because I was raised as a Greek Orthodox, and I know my tradition also because Greek school made sure of that. Certainly, to somebody who doesn't need to be a Byzantinist but has had an upbringing like mine, one does not recognize this as a proper icon. And within the United States, where the experience of religion is very different than in Greece and other European countries, Lenz has provoked discussion on what is an icon and also what is it like a saint, because there is a saint is popular faith in a saint, in a person's abilities, spiritual abilities, leads to sainthood. But sainthood is also a formalized process that the institutional church is in charge of. So if I say Harvey Milk is a saint, he's certainly not a saint in any institutional church. He may be a saint to several individuals. So this is my reaction. I think I understand where he's coming from. And icons already in the Byzantine period, since the very beginning, in the early Christian period, were supposed and were talking about important theological and social issues of their day. And the question is how we choose to do it and how we view the position of religion in the societies in which we live and the position of the institutional churches in the societies where we live.
There's a question around the Byzantine civilization. How was it influenced by its neighbors? So looking at it as a cultural inference in the opposite direction.
Okay, I say that again.
Looking at the cultural influence in the opposite direction, that is, how was the Byzantine civilization influenced by its neighbors? Not only how it influenced its neighbors, but how was it influenced by its neighbors?
Of course it was influenced by its neighbors big time. And the easiest way to understand this is to see how the United States is influenced by the different cultures that that live in, you know, not just immigrants, but you know, neighboring peoples. There aren't that many of those. But every empire, including the American Empire, in order to be worthy of its name, has to be multicultural and to a certain degree also multilingual and all of that. So there's no doubt that Byzantium was influenced by the cultures of its neighbors. I would need another lecture to explain in which concrete ways. And again, what we deem as its neighbors is also subject to interpretation. So if we say that Byzantium is a Greek phenomenon, then Latin culture is its neighbors. If we say that at least until the 7th century it's a Greco-Latin phenomenon, then Latinity is part of Byzantine culture and not a culture of its neighbors. And of course, and so on and so forth. I mean, I invite me for another lecture.
What impact on the view of the Byzantine Empire would a conversion of Hagia Sophia from a museum to a mosque have?
Say that again.
What impact on the view of the Byzantine Empire would a conversion of Hagia Sophia from a museum to a mosque have?
I think it depends on the view of the beholder. So there are different ways of looking at this. I mean, the conversion of Hagia Sophia from a mosque to a museum by Kemal Atatürk was a statement that the Turkish Republic is a secular state. And the discussions to a reconversion to a mosque are assertions that modern Turkey is no longer the same secular state that it had been.
Yep,
For some people, this may be a good thing. For other people, it may be a bad thing. And the image of Byzantium depends on how you evaluate this 21st century discussion, not any kind of imagined essence of Byzantium.
Besides you mentioned the bureaucracy and the ability to admit the administration capability, what are the most significant contributions of the Byzantine Empire? Arts, literature, what other aspects was it, you know, did it have a significant contribution, cultural contribution?
You mean beyond the economics or what?
Beyond the economics and the administration, which is one of the themes that you said at the beginning, which it was very well known for. Did it have other significant contributions in arts, literature, et cetera, et cetera?
Yes, again, this is a topic of debate and not just recent debate. Well, let me start from literary culture, because this is the poorest known component of Byzantine civilization. And most Byzantine texts remain unpublished. They don't exist in editions. They're not easily accessible. They only exist in manuscripts, which means there's a vast amount we do not know about Byzantine literary culture. Until maybe 30 years ago, Byzantium was not supposed to even have a literary culture. As a graduate student in the early 90s at Harvard, I was faced with the assertion that I cannot possibly be studying Byzantine literature because Byzantine literature did not exist. It was all hagiography, liturgy, and historiography. This is not literature. I'm not saying this is my opinion. But as a graduate student, I was faced with this assertion that I can't be studying what I'm studying because it didn't exist. And I myself, as a graduate student, have pronounced the words, Byzantine science did not exist. Here I am 30 years later, and I am one of the so-called experts on Byzantine science. This is a big part of what I'm studying. So you understand that even in my own sense of what the contribution of Byzantium may have been, I am evolving myself. And until the day I die, I will not have known. The question of the influence of Byzantine art has been asked much earlier. And especially, this is an old debate already from the 50s and 60s. because did Byzantium, the question was, did Byzantium participate in any way to European civilization? And if it did, how do we know that it did? What is the evidence? Already several decades ago, art history has concentrated, let's say, on Byzantinizing elements in the art of Giotto in the Italian Renaissance, and also Byzantinizing elements in the art of Domenico Stratocopoulos, El Greco, because we know beyond doubt that he had been trained also in the Byzantine tradition. And it's very interesting that Hadzidakis, who was a Greek Byzantinist, who knew the Byzantine tradition really well, denied a Byzantine influence in the really great art of El Greco in the Western style. And more recent art history is revising this idea of Hadzidakis. So again, I'm not evading the question. I'm just trying to explain that there are no steady answers. Scholarship is dynamic. That's why art historians and historians and people like me will always have jobs.
I'm going to combine two questions into one. There's a question around, are you optimistic about the continued growth of scholars in the of Byzantium in the American Academy? With another one saying, how do you propose the study of the Byzantium should proceed, not how it is currently, and what are your personal thoughts around the evolution of the studies around Byzantium?
All right. So if I'm optimistic about the future of Byzantine studies in the US, yes, I am. And the reason is that I see already since the 80s, and we experience it even more acutely currently, there is a demand to reconfigure an inherited curriculum, like a so-called Western canon. And this is an endless discussion. I cannot cover everything that I think in this answer, but I think Byzantine studies at the hands of an intelligent Byzantinist has the potential to help reconfigure the inherited canon in ways that speak to issues of today. And that's exactly why I chose to focus on the African-American reception of Byzantine art in the lion's share of my talk. And so I am optimistic because I see that in issues that are hot right now as we speak, Byzantine civilization has something to say. How I see my own work evolving? Is that the second question?
How do you see the field evolving as, you know, the Byzantine studies field? Do you see that, you know, the trends of the field?
The trends of the field are different at different, you mean in the States, right?
Or yes.
Yes. I don't know, we each do our own work. I'll give an example again from my preparation for this talk. I knew from Nick Kouraidis that Helen Evans, whom I thank very much for her attendance today, to my mind, the most influential Byzantinist in the United States. She's the curator of the Byzantine material at the Met and the person who got more than 1 million people in the United States see Byzantine art at a series of extremely successful exhibitions. And I thought, you know, I want Helen to hear this talk because I want her to do something about this African-American reception of Byzantine art. So I got in touch with her, thanks also to Nick, who let me know that Helen was interested. And lo and behold, I find out that Helen was already planning something. So this is not, I had been thinking of this material since 1990, as I said, since I first saw the icon of Christ as a Maasai warrior. But I've been thinking of this in isolation. And I don't know since when Helen has been thinking of it, but we are both picking up this zeitgeist, like this something in the air, because scholarship ideally has to and not exist in isolation of society, from society, but speak to society, not in order to chime in always with what society wants to hear, but to say something that is of importance to society at that moment, not for the sake of reception, but for the sake of improving the world that we live in. At least this is how I experience what I do. That's what I think I'm doing.
Maria, there's another question around Byzantine history and how it's taught in Greek schools today. Uh-huh. What angles do they use to teach Byzantine history?
I cannot say how it's taught in Greek schools today because I was a school child several decades ago. So I can only say how it was taught when I was a school child, and that's not relevant. I saw one book that was sent to me at my request maybe 10 years ago, and I didn't like it. But that's all I'm going to say.
Okay. There's another question around, you talk a lot about culture and modern culture. What movies with a Byzantine setting exist? The person says is the only one that comes to mind to them, which is 1453, Fetih 1453. So any, as part of this cultural, being part of the cultural discussion, what the movies are depicted in the context of the Byzantium?
I do not know what 1453 is as a movie. If it's in what country was it made? The only movie on a broadly Byzantine topic I'm aware of is, I forget the title, but it was about the story of Hypatia as a martyr to the pagan cause with the famous American actress. I forget the details now. I confess I don't watch the movies, like I haven't been to the movies in more than 20 years, 22. I have a 22-year-old son and I have a 7-year-old daughter. So right at the cusp of when I was gonna go to the movies, I stopped going again. So I don't know the movies like that are made now. What I do know is that in Greek cinema, which again, I haven't followed since 1990 when I came to this country, but in the glory days of the Greek cinema, there were no movies with a Byzantine inspiration story that I remember of. I don't know them. The movies that I am aware of about 1453, as the person asking the question points out, are Turkish movies. And that's because I became aware of them at Harvard as a graduate student. It was a joke. Our Turkish friends would invite us to watch what was a hilarious movie about the conquest of Constantinople. I mean, it was full of cliches and we thought it was funny and we're making fun of it. And Greeks and Turks were laughing together about this glorification of the conquest. And apparently, as I know from having heard a very interesting paper by a Turkish graduate student many years ago on Turkish movies about Byzantium, these were made at a point in the middle of the 20th century when Byzantium stood for the West. This is very interesting. Byzantium stood for Western Europe. And these movies were a kind of protest against the penetration of Western financial and political interests in the modern state of Turkey. So the Byzantine became a symbol for the West, whereas for the West, the Byzantine is an Oriental. Again, an example of what I keep saying, it's a matter of where you stand. Like it depends on the beholder, what you interpret as what.
I'm going to take one or two final questions. I understand that schools and colleges in the U.S. have always taught Greek and Latin. Byzantine studies began much later in the early 20th century. Why so late? Did the same phenomena occur in Europe, in European colleges, of introducing Byzantine studies much later?
Okay. Greek and Latin were not always taught in American academia. And when Greek was taught, let's say at Princeton, I know Nikouridis is a graduate. I taught there for a while. It was for theology. Greek was taught because it is the original language of the New Testament. So it was not taught as part of a glorious ancient civilization. The history of Greek studies in the US in and of itself deserves another lecture and a book. I'm not gonna, anyone has been, whatever. I'm not gonna lecture on that now. And in Europe, Greek has not been taught. It depends on in which European country and which part of Europe broadly we are talking about. The places where there is still the teaching of Greek and Latin as we speak is Greece, Italy, Spain, and Germany. And this is a dynamic of an older curriculum of classical studies. Byzantium is not part of any such teaching. It's very interesting for me that in all of the textbooks, like authors that we use in order to teach the classical Greek language, there is not a single Byzantine author included, including authors who wrote in extremely good Attic style from the 4th century to the 15th. So this is not, it's absent. It doesn't exist. I don't know if it will get included because it's easier to include Byzantine studies at the undergraduate level than it is to include at the high school level. And the future of Byzantine studies in many ways depends on how well acquainted the younger generation of kids and then scholars is with the Greek language.
That's great. One final clarification. Fatih 1453, a friend of ours saying, is a Turkish movie. There's a Netflix TV series for those who are interested called The Rise of Empires about the fall of Constantinople, which is generally seen as less propagandistic than Fatih. But I wanted to, I know that we've gone beyond the allotted time. I wanted to Jacob, if you could allow everyone to unmute themselves and give a very warm applause and a warm thank you to Maria for a very informative and very interesting lecture.
Thank you.
And just to let everyone know that this is the first of the virtual series that we're putting together. The second one that we're planning to do is with last year we had a lecture on Pavlos Samios on broken history, which is his exhibition that he has done on Greek broken dreams with Greek antiquity that was done in the Byzantine Museum in Athens and was very, very successful. And we're going to have that lecture within the next, you know, month or month and a half to continue the series over the course of the summer. But I wanted again to thank, first of all, Maria, also Nick, Peter, Jacob, for everyone who helped make this event happen, and hope you've enjoyed it, and we will be in touch very soon. Thank you very much. Nick, do you want to say something and conclude?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Good. As Pericles said, this is the first of a series. And actually, we encourage any of you online, if you have ideas for different events that we can do virtually, please let us know, because we're looking for as much material as we can that will communicate these ideals and also be a way to inspire people during this period of time. So again, thank you very much for joining. We had an incredible turnout, way over 200 people. So it's been a terrific evening.
I'm very honored by the turnout. Thank you all. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Maria, for taking the time.
Thank you.
Okay. We're finished, Jacob.
Thanks, everyone.